Amanda Lappa, and I'm the assistant director at the Conneaut Arts Center. We were very thankful that Clay and Melissa opened up Arlene's Broadway Buffalo for us today for this beautiful performance, performed by the Edinburgh University Strings with Howard Lyon. Concessions are available in the back. If you do need to use the restroom, please go up that exit sign to your left. It is a co-ed bathroom, but the toilets are separate, no fear. Please silence all cell phones. Make sure they're on silent. If you do have to make a call, please go outside to not disrupt the performance. And I do have a collection basket in the back. If you didn't hit me at the beginning of the performance, do so after. No fee, it's a free concert, so please sit back and enjoy the performance.
Through one of those communication goofs that happens to people, we don't have programs, so I will try to keep you posted. Our dress rehearsal was Thursday night. Nobody came. So that was intelligent, I'm sure. We're going to play two Scottish tunes. One of them is a lamentation for James Moray of Abercarney, and the second one is Tonight My Sleep Will Be Restless. The general theme of this performance is going to be basically romance and love, and we're not sure who is lamenting for the first guy, and the second one is presumably somebody who's just fallen in love and is not going to sleep well, trying to figure out what the possibilities are.
Thank you.
lot of movements to it, so don't worry about that a lot. Well, you can clap anytime you want to. We need it. This is music that was written to accompany a play. The play has a long, long, convoluted history. It was written by Henry Purcell for his brother, who was doing a production of Abdelazer, or The Moor's Revenge. This is a play by Aphra Behn from about 50 years earlier. Aphra, A-P-H-R-A, Behn, B-E-H-N. You can look this up later. It's a very fascinating playwright, only about 80 years after Shakespeare. Very good, and a woman. Now there's a surprise. And this production was put on in the Globe Theater. And it's a twisted thing as far as romance goes. First of all, Henry Purcell died very soon after this production. And how he died, his brother owned the theater. Henry Purcell was the musician that wrote this music. And Henry Purcell's wife did not like his behavior because typically he would stay long at the theater and was not coming home at reasonable hours. So she told him, at one point or another, you're going to come home and you're going to find the place locked, and I won't unfasten it. So to make a long story short, he did, and she did. He was kept outside in very cold weather. He died of exposure, pneumonia that followed it. So there's a moral here. Abdelazer was based on a previous play that was called Lust's Dominion, or The Lascivious Queen. And there, nobody knows for sure who wrote that play, but that's the plot that Aphra Behn used. So here's the circumstances. The King of Spain invades Morocco, takes over the city of Fez, F-E-Z, kills the king, and brings home the king's son, Abdelazer. And gives him an education, makes him the general of the Moorish guard in the castle. And I brought a friend to finish telling this story. So we're going to play all of these movements. And it's different than like a football game. You have the game and then you put music in it. We're going to have the music, we're going to have the plot in between. And my friend, oh man. Never mind.
He's worked hard for this special status. He leads a special army unit, the Moorish Guards. His rank entitles him to special privileges. Servants are constantly at his beck and call to fulfill his every desire.
Thank you.
also his wife's. Every day she lays down her scepter for 2 hours and leaves the politics of the day to receive Angelazer in her chambers in the utmost secrecy. The initial enthusiasm which Angelazer has gone about this task soon fades, and he's beginning to feel exploited. Furthermore, his conscience is troubling him. You see, I forgot to mention it, but 6 weeks ago, Abdelazer, or Love Tender and True, married the beautiful, noble lady, Fiorella. Bedroom. There he poisons the royal honey milk. 5 minutes and one big gulp later, and the murder of his father is avenged. Exhilarated by this easy success, he plans his next steps. The queen must die. Ultimately, he wants to be left alone with his doe-eyed Fiorella. Meanwhile, on the next floor, the queen, a little affected by her husband's death, makes her own plan. Thank you. The story continues apace. After 3 days of national mourning, accompanied by 3 days of fasting and feasting, the crowd Prince Fernando is crowned king. He's the eldest son of the late king without any noteworthy rival. It's an easy decision. Numerous intrigues and scandals have exiled his brother far away from the throne. And his sister? Well, Leonora may be bright, but there are better uses for a princess, such as diplomatic marriage in a neighboring kingdom in a great crisis. In such cases, it's always useful to have a princess up one's sleeve.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mozart is usually considered a classical composer, and it was Beethoven that usually gets credit for starting romantic music. And I kind of tend to disagree with the music texts on this subject. I thought that was pretty exciting. Anyway, we're going to do another piece which is by someone you've heard of, but not by his real name. There was a musician in the 50s and 60s by the name of Moondog. Moondog had a space in the New York City subway near where the New York Philharmonic guys went for rehearsals and for concerts. So he met Leonard Bernstein and all these other guys, Philip Glass, all these other guys that were there. How he got there is kind of a long story, but it's worth telling. Lewis Hardin was the son of an Episcopal priest and a teacher who worked in a private school. Together, his parents had written a book pointing out the continuing influence of the Anglican Church on politics in the United States. And the Episcopal Church didn't want these secrets to get out particularly. So they relegated him, they gave him an exile to Episcopal Siberia. You have to understand that the way the religious stuff works in this country, the Catholics came by canoe, Pierre Marquette coming up the Mississippi. The Methodists came horseback, the circuit riders and all that. And the Episcopalians basically waited to go west until there were parlor cars. But the Hardins were in Montana or Colorado or somewhere out there, I'm not sure where. And young Lewis Hardin grew up learning how to drum from an Indian chief. And he got interested in percussion, was really good at it, enjoyed all the things that a red-blooded American boy would do to celebrate the 4th of July with dynamite caps, was what he did. And he put out both his eyes. He was put into a residential school for the blind, studying music there, reading music, becoming a musician for a blind person is quite a lot different than what we do. We sit here and read it. They've got to read the Braille, and then they can play it. So they have to memorize it, and then go to their instrument. So if they're going to use printed music, otherwise they are stuck with improvising and stuff like that. So that's how he got his start. After he had a recording that was made some money, he basically went back to classical music. But the story that this song comes from, he was in New York, he'd left his subway post and he was walking toward where he lived, and he got backed between, there was a truck backing up with his tailgate down, pinned him between the truck and the wall. Messed up several of his ribs. The truck driver didn't know he was there ever and drove off, leaving him crumpled up on the pavement in a cold, cold night. The second cold story on a composer, isn't it, today? Anyway, he had a Braille machine with his percussion equipment, so he wrote this song kind of as a last will and testament to his girlfriend, who he later went to Europe with and who wrote down most of his music. So this shows up in his second string quartet. This is a romance.
Thank you.
story to tell. Is there anybody here, raise your hand, is there anybody here who has not heard of H.T. Burley from 20 miles from here? Okay. There was a guy by the name of Hamilton Waters, who was a slave in Maryland, who bought his own freedom, and his mother's too. He wasn't expensive, neither was his mother. His mother was very elderly by the time he was able to do this, and he himself was partially blind. When he was a kid, by age 8, he was caught with a book under his shirt. It was illegal for slaves to learn how to read or to own books there. So he got 70 lashes, some of them on the face. Took out his optic nerve. He moved. He was hoping to go to Canada, but stopped in Erie, Pennsylvania. Had 3 jobs for most of his life. He was a presser of men's pants. You can feel the iron where it is. He was a lamplighter for the First Ward. This is the lower east side of Erie on the east side. And he was town crier for the same ward. He would go to the major intersections and holler out the news. That was his job. He had a daughter. He married a woman who was a Chippewa Indian. I think she left him. I'm not sure of the story there. So he has a daughter to bring up. And he figured that if slave owners have laws that they enforce so stringently about education, I want that for my daughter. So he sent her to Avery College in down by Pittsburgh. And she had degrees in Latin, French, and Greek. She came back to Erie. She got married very soon thereafter. She had a job at the Erie School District as a janitor. Now, don't start jumping to the conclusion that she wasn't hired because she was black. She wasn't hired because she was married. Teachers in those days were not allowed to be married because, heaven help us, their students would find out where babies came from, and they didn't want that to happen. I'm not making this up. Now, had she been single and Irish, she would have gotten no job in Erie at that time. So, go figure. But in any event, she had one son by the name of Harry Burley, and he sang with his mother, went out on his grandfather's lamplighting routes, and sang spirituals from the plantation that his grandfather taught him, and sang really well. Learned some piano. His mother, by the way, had the biggest Sunday school classes in all of Erie. She was much in demand because she was educated. She was a First Methodist. She was at First Presbyterian. She was at First Baptist Church. All the big churches, and at the temple too, at the synagogue. And young H.T. sang in those places and in the big houses on Millionaire Row. There was Everett McDowell's mother, who was a Chautauqua pianist on tour. She came through the town and heard this kid and said, wow, that's pretty good. You better send him to New York. Antonin Dvorak had just gone to New York as the head of a music school. And he was the highest paid classical musician in the world at the time. So the community, Erie, bless its soul, took up a collection and sent him to school in New York City. His journals for the day exist, how much he's paid for shoes, how much he paid for piano rental in his digs. And he also took a job in the cafeteria. Burley heard him whistling sometime once upon a time and said, where did you get that song from? And my grandfather taught it to me. So, okay, I want you to come into my house. I got some finches to be trained. It used to be a thing where you taught your birds how to do specific songs. And so young H.T. Burley taught Dvorak a whole bunch of spirituals. Dvorak later on denied it, but if you listen really closely to the New World Symphony, there's a tune, swing low, sweet chariot. That's where that comes from, maybe. Dvorak says no, he wrote in the style of, but he did learn a lot from young H.T. Burley. We're going to do a piece called Frolic. It's from the Southland. It's a piano series. If you're a pianist, you can look this up. It's in the public domain. You can find it and learn it. And there's poetry that introduces this, and the poetry is written by the wife. I'm not going to do the poem, but you should go from home from here and look up H.T. Burley. That's worth it. The Frolic. If ever I find it. And in case you didn't know, after your work was done on on the plantation, you were allowed to have a party now and then. So that's where this comes from.